And I'm going to talk about the impact of anatomic discoveries on prostate cancer surgery. And the story begins in 1904 with Hugh Hampton Young, the founder of modern urology, an individual who was awarded the Amory Prize in 1940, who performed the first radical prostatectomy via the perineal technique at Johns Hopkins Hospital. In 1947, an Irish surgeon, Terence Millen, developed the radical retropubic approach, which is sort of a transabdominal approach, which is what is done today, and he received the Amory Prize in 1954. But by 1970, radical prostatectomies, as you learned from Dr. Page, were rarely performed despite their effective control of cancer because of major side effects. There was major bleeding, often life-threatening. 100% of men were impotent, and 10 to 25% were totally incontinent. And like David said, patients and their physicians thought that the treatment was worse than the disease. And in 1974, when I arrived at Hopkins, I was surprised to realize that even at Johns Hopkins, where the operation originated, it was rarely performed. And at that time, I wondered why the side effects occurred and if they could be prevented. And in my comments of thanks talking about mentorship, I don't think I would have ever made these contributions had I not been at Hopkins. Hopkins has been a wonderful place to be. Quietly, without saying it, there is the expectation that your major job is discovery. The first day I went to lunch at Johns Hopkins, I sat next to Vernon Mountcastle, who was a member of this organization, distinguished neuroscientist. I introduced myself and I said, I'm the new urologist. And expecting him to respond like I'd heard over and over again, oh, you're the new plumber, I heard something different. He said, what's your field of research? And so, like every important discovery, you need an important problem to work on. And I decided I would try to find out why these side effects occurred. And what I learned very quickly was these side effects occurred because we did not understand the anatomy around the prostate. Bleeding occurred because the anatomy of these major veins that were responsible for this bleeding had not been charted. Impotence occurred because the location of the innervation of the cavernous nerves was not known, and incontinence occurred because our understanding of the sphincters responsible for passive urinary control was incorrect. Now, why? It was because all of this anatomy had been studied in the adult cadaver. As you can see in the upper right-hand portion of this slide, the prostate is shrouded by dense fascia, which conceals the surrounding anatomy. And in the post-mortem state, the abdominal viscera compress the pelvic organs into a thick pancake of tissue, and formalin fixatives dissolve the fatty planes, making the identification of anatomic structures impossible. So what was the solution? Using the operating room as an anatomy laboratory and fetal dissections. Now, all of this is chronicled in this article, which was published on the 25th anniversary of the first operation. Well, the first thing I tackled was bleeding. And using the operating room as an anatomy laboratory, I identified a common trunk over the urethra. Now, of course, you didn't see all of this schematic here, but you had to imagine underneath this shroud of tissue where it was. Merrill Sossman, the great radiologist at the Brigham, had the great expression, you only see what you look for, and you only look for what you know. So here I was looking for something I didn't know. But identifying this common trunk was an important observation because it led to a surgical technique that reduced blood loss. And this bloodless field made it possible to perform a safer, more precise, and thorough cancer operation. Well, soon after developing the technique for controlling bleeding, in 1977, a 58-year-old man returned 3 months following surgery and told me that he was fully potent. I mean, how could this be? At that time, everyone believed that because all men were impotent following surgery, the nerves had to run through the prostate. But I knew from this one case that this was not true. But where were the nerves? The answer was not in any textbook. But in 1981, I was a visiting professor at the University of Leiden. And I spent the afternoon with Peter Donker, who was the retired professor emeritus and chairman of the department, who was a neuro-urologist, and who was using a dissecting microscope to study the nerves that innervate the bladder in a stillborn male infant. When I asked to see the branches to the corpora cavernosa, the nerves responsible for erectile function, he said he had never looked. And 3 hours later, we had identified them outside the prostate. So here you see the infant cadaver, the prostate, the urethra, the bladder. Here are these nerves that he was dissecting out. And here are the branches to the corpora cavernosa, clearly outside the prostate. Well, based on this observation, we knew where the cavernous nerves were located in a tiny fetus, much the way you would have a schematic for your television set. You know, but how would you find that transistor? Identify these microscopic structures in the adult male pelvis. Well, when I returned to Hopkins once again, I used the anatomy laboratory, the operating room, as an anatomy laboratory. And what I realized was that the capsular arteries and veins of the prostate traveled in exactly the same location as the nerves in the fetus, and I speculated that the neurovascular bundle could be used as the interoperative landmark to identify these microscopic nerves. And on April 26, 1982, armed with that information, I operated on the patient you see here. It was the first patient who underwent this operation. This was at the 25th anniversary, and God willing, if he lives until next month, he will have 30 years cancer-free with a normal quality of life. Well, from there, I went on to perform detailed neuroanatomical studies to provide templates for surgeons, to delineate the fascia around the prostate, making it a better cancer operation, and then embarked upon a 29-year journey of perfecting the technique, again, using the operating room as an anatomy laboratory, changing one thing at a time, 28 major changes over 29 years in 4,569 patients. I maintained a database from day one, documenting changes in technique, cancer control, and quality of life. I constantly reevaluated outcomes, and eventually I had to use video for documentation. I could do the same operation on two men on the same day, and one of them was perfect to 3 months, and one of them took a year or longer. So the differences, I learned that minor differences in technique had a major impact. So I videotaped cases, looked at outcomes, reviewed those videotapes frame by frame. Yes, my wife is a saint if I spent my summer vacations doing that, to identify some of the changes that were made. And I used these videos to teach others. So let me discuss and come to sort of what were the accomplishments of this. First of all, a reduction in death from prostate cancer. As David pointed out, prostate cancer is the most common cancer in men. It is also the second most common cause of cancer death in men in the United States. Well, the Scandinavian Prostate Cancer Group carried out a very brave randomized trial, randomizing men to surgery versus watchful waiting. And last year in the New England Journal of Medicine, the 15-year follow-up was published. And in the men who would benefit the most, men under the age of 65 who were most likely to live 15 years, across the board, there was a relative reduction in metastases, in death from any cause, and in death from cancer. Now, what's the impact of this? In 1983, as Dr. Page said, only 7% of men with prostate cancer underwent surgery, and radiotherapy was too underpowered to cure. Essentially, no one was being treated with curative intent. However, with the reduction in side effects and improved safety, by 1993, one-third of men, 100,000 men that year, underwent surgery. And if we apply the results of the Scandinavian trial at 15 years today, there should be a dramatic reduction in the number of men dying of the disease or suffering from painful metastases. Now here we look at the changes in mortality in cancers in men and women between 1994 and the year 2003. Here you see increases, and here you see declines in mortality, and you can see the greatest decline in mortality over that decade was a decline in deaths from prostate cancer. The operation was also safer. With a reduction in blood loss, the 30-day mortality fell from 2% to 0.2%, and the hospital length of stay decreased from 2 weeks to where it is today, 1 to 2 days. And improved quality of life. Today, significant incontinence should be less than 2%, And sexual function can be preserved in 80 to 90% of men who have normal sexual function preoperatively if it is possible for optimal cancer control to preserve both neurovascular bundles and if the procedure is performed by a skilled surgeon. What's been the impact on research? In breast and colon cancer, tissue was always available for pathologic correlation and biochemical molecular study, and this accelerated discovery in these fields. However, prior to the development of nerve-sparing approaches, only 7% of men with localized disease underwent surgery, and thus only small needle biopsy specimens were available for research. However, today, tissue harvested from surgical specimens has galvanized research. And indeed, I believe in the long run, the contribution of surgery that may have the greatest impact in reducing death is by increasing research in the field. So what has been the impact of anatomic discoveries? Improved surgical exposure, reduced blood loss, wider surgical margins. It's made it possible to preserve potency. It has improved urinary continence, has reduced deaths from prostate cancer, has galvanized research in the field. So in closing, I'd like to thank the residents, faculty, and support staff, past and present at Hopkins, who over the last 30 years have made possible the discoveries that I've summarized in this talk tonight. And I'd like to thank my patients, who have been my partners in discovery. And thank all of you for being here.